allow me, Mr. Oh, Mr. 散らされるほど切ない、二人だけの危ないゲーム。 Love is war, love is war, love is war.
Welcome to the War and Love Podcast.
Welcome back, guys.
This is episode 7. I am your host, Mike, and with me again,
I am Ashley.
And this episode, we are covering two movies that that are kind of related in terms of their themes, but differ in some retrospects. But we'll get into that later. So to start, we're going to go right into the warm-up.
Yep. And I know you have a lot to say.
Yeah.
So without further ado, you have your 10 minutes.
Okay.
Starting now.
So I think it was last episode, or it might have been the episode before, I was talking about that the Final Fantasy VII remake was coming out. It came out not last Friday, but the Friday before that. I have mentioned this before, but the Final Fantasy VII is not only my favorite Final Fantasy game, but my favorite game. Came out in 1997. I didn't play it till 2003 or 2004. I didn't have a PS1. I borrowed it from a friend when I had a PS2 back in like middle school or something. But not to waste too much time, I have a lot of thoughts on this game. After finishing it, and I'm actually on my second playthrough, there's some pros and some cons. I'm not going to get into some of the cons right now. I'm gonna leave a spoiler in a moment. But let me touch on the pros first, the things I can talk about. So first, if you have ever played the original Final Fantasy VII, you know that the combat is time-based. So it's similar to a turn-based combat system wherein you have characters on your team and your enemies take turns to perform actions. What time-based adds is a mechanic wherein there is a gauge that increases over time for each character, and that gauge is what allows you to perform an action, but that action being perform an attack, perform magic, use an item, so on and so forth. And your enemies have the same thing. They also have a gauge. And you could screw with that in the original game, wherein you could cast spells that could increase the amount of time it takes for your enemies to wait for them to perform an action, and reduce the amount of time it takes for you to perform an action. So a lot of it was based off of how much time it takes for everybody to perform an action. And you could kind of screw with that, and it was fun. This game is similar in that retrospect. There is a real-time combat aspect wherein you can attack an enemy. You don't need to wait for anything. What you are waiting for in this case is the gauge that you do have to grow to perform an action, in the sense of an item that you can use, magic that you can cast, or an ability. These abilities are, for the most part, much more powerful attacks that you can perform on an enemy. Some of them are attacks, some of them are healing. It depends on the character that you have. Every character has their own abilities. And
do you play as all of the characters?
You do. Which, in the original, you did also. For the most part, every character performed the same in the original.
Mm.
You know, there was no real distinguishment between them. In this game, there actually is, which I kind of liked. So the main character, Cloud, has a sword. He's best at up close and personal attacks, but he's more slower and powerful, like really slow but extremely powerful attacks. He's also really good at defense. So he's more your tank. He gets up and close and personal. He takes a lot of damage and he helps protect the other characters. Then you have like Tifa, who is the bare-fisted girl who is good at building up a critical meter. So that's the other thing that's different about this game, that's kind of similar to Final Fantasy 13, wherein your enemies have what's called a stagger meter. And the more critical hits you do to them, you build up the stagger meter, and once they're staggered, they become incapacitated for a period of time where you can do a lot more damage to them. So Tifa's really good at doing critical hits. The offset, though, is that because she's so good at doing critical hits, she takes a lot more damage. Then you have Aerith, who's your mage. She's good at staying back, healing your party, helping support them, cast spells on the enemies. And then Barret, who is your long-range rifle person. Like, he has his gun arm where he fires it, and he does a lot of damage at enemies that the other characters can't reach. So he's good if you want to switch to him and have options to be able to kind of stay out of the enemy's line of sight. So the combat's really fun. I really enjoyed it. It's probably my best, like, my favorite thing of this game. The environments also look amazing. This is actually the first game in a series of games for Final Fantasy VII. So they didn't remake the whole game. They remade the first part of the game, and it's going to be continuous like that. I'll get into that in a moment when I get to the spoilers, but this is the first section of the game, which is Midgar. It's like the first beginning area you are in the game. You look like you have a question.
I'm confused, I guess.
So in the original game, there is this, you're brought to Midgar. So let me actually dive a little bit into the plot real quick so you have some perspective. So what made Final Fantasy VII so interesting is that it's a very modern story in the sense that it has a very, it has a setting that makes sense to us. It's kind of near future where there's a lot of like mechanized like robots and things like that. But they have this company, this corporation called Shinra that is harvesting from the planet energy as a source for everybody. Now, they are the primary source of energy for the whole world, right? And they built a city called Midgar, like, for them. They built it for them and the people who want to live there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a small part of the world, but they own that world. They are essentially, like, think of the capitalist society of America, but think, like, as if there's only one company that owns everything. They own the news, they own politicians, they own everything, and that's Shinra. And the main characters are eco-terrorists who are trying to destroy the power plants of this company because what is found is that they're draining life from the planet, and as they're doing it, it's causing the planet to slowly die. And so you're trying to disrupt that, even though it's going to prevent people from having energy, it's going to save the planet because it's causing problems. And they know this, like Shinra knows this, but they don't care. They're doing it anyway. So that's what makes it a really interesting and kind of like
relatable concept.
You have a capitalist society that is run by corporations that are destroying the planet and don't care about it. Sound a little, you know,
facts.
Yeah. Back to the point. The cast is trying. That's the whole crux of the plot of Final Fantasy VII. At least a good chunk of it is Midgar. That's that portion of the game, and you are trying to disrupt that. So you're going to power plants and everything like that. So the environment of Midgar in the original game because it's such an old game, it wasn't really fleshed out as much. In this game, it's amazing the level of detail they did. It's incredible. And
weren't they working on it for like 17 years?
No. They were working on it for like 5 years. Oh. But still, the level of detail that they fleshed out is incredible. I was pretty impressed. There's like a lot of environments that are really nostalgic. So it's like you see them in your mind. You're like, this is how I pictured it when I first played it, how it, you know, I thought it was, but it's just that amazing.
So they didn't show it in the original game? They just referenced
it? There's some environments that they do show, but again, it's so low poly and it's charming. Like, the cool things about the original is because of the system limitations they had, they kind of made it so things look like dollhouses. So you go in there and it's really interesting. The characters look like dolls. Like, it's interesting. Here, they're like really high fidelity, so it's a different perspective, but I kind of like it. And that kind of leads also into like the combat and everything. There's enemies in the game that are really fucking weird in the original. Like, you fight a house that turns into like, it like opens up and it's like turns into like this robot thing that basically lures people in to eat them, this house. Now, I was like, oh yeah, I was like waiting to actually fight that in the game, like the remake, and it never shows up. And I'm like, okay, well, you know, whatever. It's a fucking boss. Like, in the end of a chapter, it's a, like, they go, okay, here's this extra, like, enemy, you're gonna fight, and I'm like, okay, I wonder who it is, and they're like, it's, and they, like, start kind of alluding to it, I'm like, no way. And then they showed, I'm like, oh god, it's the house! I'm like, yes! This is so great. But there's a lot of moments like that, where they show that. The music is also amazing, the main character designs are great. But this is kind of where I'm gonna start getting into the cons. So, firstly, A couple of the character portrayals I don't really like as much. One of those being Tifa. Now, I really like Tifa, but one of the things I really liked in the original game is that Tifa is a fucking badass. Like, and she is in this game too, but she's a part of the group. Like, the main character, Cloud, he is a mercenary who's a former soldier who used to work for Shinra. And he left Shinra. The details of that are not very well explained initially. You learn later. And Tifa is his childhood friend. She is part of the Eco-Terrorist group, and she is getting you to join and help, you know, take down Shinra. And in the original game, she's really strong-willed. She's the type of person who's very focused. She doesn't get angry, but she knows what she wants to do. She wants to take down Shinra, and she doesn't give a fuck about, like, I mean, she understands
what happens in the...
Like, she understands that there's, that blowing up, like, a reactor has ramifications, but she knows that it's for the good of the planet and everything. In this game, she's very unsure of herself, and I kind of don't like that, because I liked in the original game her being, you know, assertive. And there's a scene in the game where, like, or a chapter where you go in this friggin' graveyard, like this train graveyard, where she's afraid of ghosts. Now, in the original game, she wouldn't give a fuck. She would have punched a ghost in the face. That's how, like, tough she was, and that's what made her interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I still like her in this game. I just don't like that she's basically a waifu. Like, even more of a waifu of what she was before. Before, she was a waifu because she was, like, strong. And you were like, that's attractive. I like, you know, someone who's, like, powerful. They know who she is. She knows who she is. She knows what she wants. You know, here, she's kind of, like, more of a waifu than she was before. There's also another character in this game who was a side character kind of in the original, Jessie. I like a lot about her, but she's really sexualized in this game. Like, she really flirts a lot with Cloud. Like, she wants to fuck Cloud hard. Like, she goes as close as possible to saying, I want to fuck you. At one point in the game, she says, can you come back to my room, like, later or something like that? It's like, dude, come on, man. Like, and I don't know. It kind of gets a little bit annoying, but other than that, most of the cast I really enjoy. And I still like Tifa. I just find it a little annoying that kind of went that way with her. And then there's the other part that I don't really like, and that's Sephiroth. Now, Sephiroth is the main villain of Final Fantasy VII. And what makes Sephiroth really interesting in the original is that you don't really see him much.
Mm-hmm.
He's kind of talked about, like, in whispers.
Like Voldemort?
Kind of, yeah. Like, kind of like Voldemort. Obviously, that came out before that. Final Fantasy VII, but he's talked about, like, a rumor. Like, he was also a soldier. He worked for Shinra, but he was the most powerful soldier. He was the best that ever was, and he defected, and he apparently died. That was the rumor. Now, there's then rumors that he is alive, and that he has been spotted. And throughout the entire part of Midgar in the first Final Fantasy game, you never see him. And then at the end, for the next, like, 5 seconds, spoilers for Final Fantasy VII, the original. If you haven't played the game, this is a spoiler. I'm not going to put this in a separate section because it's, like, a 20-something-year-old game, but here's the spoiler right now. Sephiroth kills the head of Shinra, the mm-hmm. boss, in the original game towards the end of the Midgar section.
Mm-hmm.
Spoilers are over. And in the original, you never saw him. Like, even then, you just saw the aftermath, right? And there's people that you meet there who say they saw him, but you don't. So what makes his mystique really interesting is that you never see him.
Mm-hmm.
And you, after you get out of Midgar in the original game, you kind of follow along his path because you're trying to follow him to mm-hmm. stop him from what his goal is, which his goal is to basically destroy the planet, or rather conquer it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he thinks that he is a god, essentially, and his right is to own the planet. I'm not gonna get into details for why he thinks that, because I think that's gonna take up too much time. But
yeah, probably. But
along the way, when you follow him to the first main village after Midgar, the second area after Midgard, you are trying to cross this path, and there's this giant serpent that you're told about is extremely dangerous. Do not fight him. He's called the Midgard Zolom, and he's like, just, you have to get on this, like, thing in order, called a chocobo, which I'm not going to explain what the hell that is, to go across and basically outrun him and get to the other side before he catches you, because you can't beat him right now. And you get to the other side, and there's the fucking snake on a giant tree branch just, like, impaled on it. And it's Sephiroth who did it. And you don't... So basically, you are told that... You're told through environmental, like, storytelling how powerful he is compared to you. Mm-hmm. And how much of a, like, obstacle he is. Like, he is so overwhelming. You know, it's amazing. But in the remake, you see him every few seconds through, like, flashbacks and shit like that. And it kind of robs that sense of mystique. It kind of... It's kind of like a, haha, here's Sephiroth, you know, you all love him kind of thing. And it's kind of annoying because...
So they're playing on that mysteriousness that you all loved, I guess, like in the original.
Yeah.
But they're changing it as like more of a nostalgia type of thing.
Right. And that's the other thing I don't like is that if this is your first time playing Final Fantasy VII, mm-hmm. and you don't know too much about Sephiroth, you're not going to get it. You're just going to think like he's just, you know, some guy. Whereas in the original, you feel that he's like powerful. You just haven't met him yet. And they kind of rob you of that. So I even made a note of that saying, if you haven't played the original Final Fantasy VII, do not play this game first, because this game is not for you. This is a game for people who have already played Final Fantasy VII and already know those beats. They already understand like the story. They already understand the characters. There's a lot of nostalgia. There's a lot of things here that you'll see that are just, if you've played the original, you'll get the references. In this, if you haven't, you're not going to understand it. You're not going to get... I mean, you could still play it, but it's not going to resonate with you as much.
It's not going to have as much impact.
Yeah. And then in terms of the combat. So, I'm doing a hard mode playthrough right now. And so, after you beat normal mode, you unlock hard mode. What's different about hard mode is you can't use items at all throughout the entire playthrough. And there's... Throughout the game, there's... And chapters, there's scattered little things called benches, where if you sit down on them, that'll replenish all your health and then replenish your magic points, which you can use to perform magic. These benches do not replenish magic points, so the only way you can heal yourself throughout those chapters, if you're in combat, is through magic or using an ability, if you have abilities that let you do that. So it makes it kind of annoying, and what makes it even more annoying is that when you're fighting and you're doing a cast that uses one of your bars that you've been building up during the fight, if you get disrupted while in the middle of casting it, you lose the magic points that you just had and you don't get the heal, which means it wastes shit for you. So you have to be very careful about when you're healing yourself. And the other annoying thing is aerial combat. So there's... Scattered throughout the chapters, there's several enemies that are in the air that if you are playing as Cloud or Tifa, who are not good at aerial combat, it's really difficult to fight. And the problem is, there's a lot of chapters where there's enemies where you do not have Barrett or Aerith who can fight. And so it makes it very frustrating. And it kind of, I don't know, the hard mode in particular, I don't know if they play tested that, because it's not as enjoyable. You have to use the same tactics for every enemy. You have to use, like, counter attacking for pretty much everyone or you're gonna die. So yeah, it's kind of annoying. I enjoy the combat for the most part, but I think it can get very repetitive. And the other thing that gets very repetitive is there's a lot of padding in the game. As I said, the original Midgar section in the original Final Fantasy VII was about 6 to 8 hours tops. I blew through it recently in like 5, and this is like 40 hours. So there is a lot that they added that I like, but there's also a lot of side quests and a lot of padding to it that feels really annoying. Like, it gets really repetitive at times, and I'm replaying it now, and there's points where I'm just like, oh my god, come on. Let's move along, come on. And then lastly, and this is the main spoiler, and I will put in a timestamp, is the ending. So if you don't want to hear this, go to the timestamp that I'm going to put in the description, because I'm going to talk about the ending now. Okay, so in the original Final Fantasy VII, as I mentioned to you before in the previous spoiler a few minutes ago, the boss of Shinra gets murdered by Sephiroth. So you then escape because you're going to rescue Aerith, who's been kidnapped by Shinra. I'm not going to get into details for why that happened, but anyway, you go to rescue her, you find that Shinra's president has been murdered by Sephiroth, you escape the building, and you're going off to the world to go and follow him. And that's the end of that part, right? in the remake, that happens too, but throughout the story, there's peppered in these hooded figures that are following you. And you're kind of initially like, who are these things? Because they weren't in the original. And you're like, what are these things? And as the story goes along, you kind of start piecing it together in your mind. You're like, wait, why do these things keep showing up when things that happened in the original feel like they're kind of deviating? Like they're not about to follow that course. There's like points in the story where there's a Cloud about to kill somebody who he didn't kill before, and they stop him. There's points where Cloud wasn't going to go to the second reactor to shut it to blow it up because they didn't invite him along with it. So they end up injuring another person so that he can come along. Those hooded fingers do the injuring. So basically, you piece together that those things are essentially plot devices. I think they call them arbiters of fate. And what they are there for is to make sure that the beats of the original story happen, right? They are trying to make sure that does play out the way that you remember. And this is why I say newcomers will not get this, because as playing this, I was like, wait, why does this seem weird? Because there are actually minor things that fall through the cracks, right? Like story beats that still do happen, even though they didn't happen in the original. And the main thing that happens towards the end is that you fight those arbiters of fate and beat them. And when you beat them, you find that Sephiroth, you end up meeting in the building after he kills the head of Shinra, he is aware of everything that's going on. So basically those arbiters of fate, as I said, are trying to keep everything flowing along the normal path. Sephiroth is aware of this, and he's also aware of the original plot of the original game.
Mm-hmm.
And what he's trying to do is help you along with defeating those arbiters of fate to give him a chance to escape his fate in the original game. Where in the original game, you beat him. After, by the way, Aerith dies in the original game. He ends up killing her. She goes off to summon this, because he ends up summoning this thing called a meteor. It's called a meteor spell, but it's an actual meteor that's going to head towards the planet and destroy it. She heads towards this location in order to cast a spell to prevent the meteor from colliding with the planet. And he jumps down and stabs her through the chest, which I still remember in the game when I first played it was surprising. But he is basically trying to disrupt that, because after she dies, your entire crew is destroyed, and also you're like, we need to fucking take this guy down. And what he's trying to do is change it in a way such that he will not be destroyed at the end of the original Final Fantasy VII. Now, in some ways, I think this is a really bold move, because now I do not know how the other games are going to go, because he has made it such that, the cast has made it such that The original story might not even play out. Like, this story might not even play out like the original game. It might go a different path. Aerith might not even die. I imagine you're still going to fight and kill Sephiroth, which, by the way, you end up fighting Sephiroth at the end of this game, which was cool, but was fucking dumb, because you don't need to fight Sephiroth at the end of this game. He is the end boss in Final Fantasy VII. He is the mountain you're trying to reach. If you fight him and take him down, what the fuck mountain are you going to go for now? You know, you've already beat him in Final Fantasy VII Remake. What is your goal now? You know, you didn't destroy him, but you defeat him.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, so I am intrigued, but also I am very nervous, because I don't really trust that they're going to be able to do it well, because it's made by the same people who did the story, the directors, same people who did the Kingdom Hearts series.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like the path that Kingdom Hearts went down, so I'm very nervous. So, if you're joining me back, my main takes on this game are you should totally play it, with the asterisk that if you played the original Final Fantasy VII, you should play this game. If you haven't, play that game first, and then come back and play this game. Because there's a lot to like about it. I really do like the game, but I have some qualms with it, and I have some apprehension going into the next couple games whenever they actually do come out. But that's the end of my piece. All right.
10 years later.
Yeah. Okay, so I know that you have been rewatching The Vampire Diaries.
Yeah. So I have been, like you said, rewatching The Vampire Diaries. That's been the main thing that I have been watching. Partly because I want to get through the season or the series again. I'm about halfway through the second season and there's 8 seasons in total with like 22 episodes in each season. So there's a lot of episodes to get through. Now, I watched this series when it first originally came out and I was following it for a really, really long time. I fell off of it towards the end of probably, I would say, like the 6th or 7th season. And to be perfectly honest with you, I don't wholly remember what kind of happened. So that was part of the reason why I kind of wanted to go back and rewatch it, just because it was something that I wanted to do for a really long time. And because we have so much time on our hands, I was like, what the fuck? I might as well do it now. And the other reason that I am rewatching it is because a lot of my TV shows that came back from their hiatus from the, I guess, from the fall or whatever it was, are now going back on break because of the whole COVID outbreak.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had recorded some of the episodes for the season, but because of the outbreak, they're now on hold to finish the season. So a lot of the series that I was watching, like Riverdale, for example, it's kind of like on hold, where it literally just came back next week or last week. And I think there's only like 2 more episodes in this season because of the whole outbreak.
Okay.
So that really, really sucks. But I mean, it's not really anything I can do. So that's kind of the reason why I've tried to stick with Netflix right now, just because everything else is kind of up in the air and I'll just wait until it all comes out and then just binge watch it. I'd prefer that. I also know that we are going to potentially, so like I told you guys, I am a kindergarten teacher and my TA who I work with, who's my coworker, she had recommend us watch Too Hot to Handle. And this is a series that I talked to Mike about and he's like, okay, well, I'll watch the first episode with you. So the premise of this series, it's kind of, my TA had recommended it because we had watched Love is Blind and it was like one of those trashy types of things where it's just like, you're engrossed in the fact that it's so ridiculous, but you need to find out what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So for this one, for Too Hot to Handle, it revolves around basically these good-looking people. I guess they went out and just found all the people that have clearly nothing wrong with them. They're perfect. Their body's perfect. They're attractive, whatever it might be. And I guess they put them somewhere. I don't really know because I haven't really done a lot of research on it. But collectively as a group, they have, I think it's like $100,000, if I'm not mistaken. And the idea around the show is that every time they either kiss or touch or fuck each other or whatever it might be, they lose money as a collective group. Now, I was intrigued and I was like, okay, well, how is this going to work? I'm like, well, why don't they just not fuck each other or touch each other?
Yeah, I had some questions around like that. I was like, what? Like,
yeah, and I mean, you even brought up, you're like, it would make more sense if like each had their own money. And that's what I originally thought, like when we were talking about it at work. And she was like, no, it's like a collective group. So I guess it's like almost kind of like their take on like peer pressure and stuff like that. But I don't know. I'm interested to watch it. We'll probably watch the first episode maybe sometime this week and we can kind of talk a little bit about it the next episode. But other than that, I mean, I am not a video game person. I, like, we played the first 2 chapters of Yakuza 0, and I liked it, but there's, for me, like, video games, I don't know, like, there's just too much, like, backstory and, like, reading and other shit like that, and I'm just like, I'm over here, and then, if you guys haven't watched our last episode, like, I literally got to a point where I was just so frustrated, because there are too many fucking buttons on the remote. And like I said, the controller.
There we go.
Like I said, I am not a video game person. Like, I grew up playing Super Mario Brothers, like any type of Mario type of game, and that was basically what I lived on. I didn't really get into anything else. And just the whole joystick and the Joy-Con, and I literally cannot use both thumbs at one time. I don't know why. I don't have the coordination to do it. It got a little bit better, but it's just really, really hard. And I also, I tried to play Luigi's Haunted Mansion because I was like, oh, well, this will just be like a fun game to pass the time. And I might still go back to it. But at the same time, I'm like, it's just getting repetitive. And I'm just, I don't know. I'm just not a video games type of person. I would much rather just binge watch TV and I like read raunchy romance novels and other shit along those lines. So,
yeah,
that's kind of what I've been up to.
Okay, then. Other than that, though, before we move on to the main segment, you did finish the Heaven's Arena arc of Hunter x Hunter.
Oh, yeah, we did.
Yeah. And what did you think of it?
I honestly, I have to say, out of all the anime that I've watched, and granted, it's not a lot, but it is still quite a bit. Like, we've watched Food Wars, we've watched Fullmetal Alchemist, we've watched Your Lie in April. What else have we watched?
Death Note you watched?
We watched Death Note. What was the one with the, like, the cyber or whatever it was?
Psychopath?
Yes, Psychopaths. I watched the first season of that.
You watched a decent amount.
Yeah, I watched a decent amount. I honestly, I would have to say Hunter x Hunter is probably one of my favorite.
It's a great show.
Out of all of the anime that I have seen. And like I said, I'll preface it by saying I have not watched the amount of anime that obviously you have watched with your anime list reaching like 200 different things or whatever it might be.
Yeah.
So I really, really like where it's going. I'm definitely intrigued to continue to watch it. And I know you said the next one is the Phantom Troop.
Yeah, we're in, currently she's on like episode 2 of the York New City arc. Yeah.
And there really hasn't anything happened yet. They're like just getting into the area and that's about all we've kind of gotten to. And I know that you said this is your favorite arc.
It is.
I'm interested to kind of see what's going to happen. And I'm also really excited to kind of see the whole, like, the four of them kind of come back together. Although I'm intrigued to find out if Leoria is going to come
back. He does come back in the York New City arc.
Does he end up learning Nen?
Eventually, yes. Not Nen until the last arc in the anime. But yeah. What did you think of the explanation of Nen and how that works? You're just now starting to see different categories of men.
It definitely makes a lot more sense now the way that they explained it. And it's interesting to see how, like, people that have, like, these other abilities when they were growing up. Like, for example, how, like, Gon grew up in nature and whatnot. And he has, like, those types of abilities that are kind of play into his Nen abilities.
Yeah.
Which is super interesting. I definitely find it's going to be kind of like a learning curve for Gon and Killua. Especially because of the type of characters they are. Like, I know them. I know they're going to want to push themselves to get to, like, the area that they're not going to be able to conquer. So I'm interested to see, like, how that will play out.
They do explore that in a great deal. It's slowly it comes along, and then in the next arc after this, they train a lot more. But yet, that leads into some really interesting things. You actually touched on something I don't want to talk about too much, but it plays a huge factor, especially in the Chimera Ant arc. It's keep that
awesome.
in your head where you say them pushing themselves to an area they can't reach. Keep that in your mind as we get to that. You know.
Yeah. So I'm definitely, obviously, still going to continue to watch it, and it's just like one of those things that's like you can always go back to and whatnot. So
yeah,
it's definitely enjoyable, and I do see myself finishing the series. So I guess we'll see.
We'll keep you updated.
Yeah, definitely.
And with that, we're gonna move into the main event. Okay. So this is our main segment of the podcast. We've explained this 6 other times before, but I'll quickly talk about it now. This segment is where Ashley and I both pitched each other an idea for a movie or a TV series that we think the other person might like. They then watch that and then grade it in 5 different categories.
And those categories are story, characters, we also have music and sound, cinematography and direction, and then overall enjoyment.
Right. And then we grade those categories in a 1 to 5 range, and those are all added up, so it's a total of 25. And then at the end of the podcast, whoever scored the highest wins the episode. So this episode, I gave Ashley Liz and the Blue Bird.
Yep. So for anybody that hasn't heard about this, and this is a Japanese animated drama film, and it's directed by Kyoto Animation. Now, as soon as this movie started playing, I automatically recognized the art style. And even at one point when you didn't realize that I was watching the movie today, you came down and you were, you asked me if I was watching
A Silent Voice.
Yeah, A Silent Voice. And as soon as you said that, I was like, oh, that's where I saw it.
Yeah.
And
it's the same studio.
It's the same studio. It's the same type of artwork. And that was really cool to see. So that was a nice little connection. And it's also, so this is a spin-off movie, and it's based off of Sound Euphorium.
Euphonium, yeah.
Euphonium, sorry. Novel series. And the spin-off is the sequel off of the television series.
Yeah.
Which I didn't realize that, and I'm kind of interested to see, like, what that television series was about. Have you watched it?
No, I know about it. I know that there's some characters that are in this movie that are in the original. But you don't have to watch the anime to understand this movie.
Yeah, this one follows Mizori and Nozomi in this one. And they were also in the television series. So this is kind of like these two characters, I guess, like side quest almost.
Yeah.
So that was really interesting for me to see. So just to kind of give you like an overall arching type of synopsis of this Japanese film. Basically what this movie is about is it explores the friendship between Mizori and Nozomi. Clearly, I am not versed in Japanese names, so I will continue to butcher them on every single episode. So forgive me. It explores the friendship between these two girls, and Mizori is the type of girl who is kind of like the loner in school. She doesn't have a lot of friends. The one friend that she does have is Nozomi, and she doesn't want to give up their friendship. And it relates around this book that Nozomi used to read when she was a little girl called Liz and the Blue Bird. And this story talks about how this other girl in the story, she was lonely as well, and then out of nowhere, a bluebird comes and turns into this little girl, and they become best friends.
Right.
Now, I don't want to go too far into that story because it also goes into the plot of the actual movie. And this movie does a really good job in switching back and forth between the book and the movie. And originally when it was happening, when the movie first started, I was like, what the fuck is going on? Like, I kind of just had to like sit and fully immerse myself in the movie to get a general idea of what was going on, because I didn't want to Google it. Like, I didn't want to see what was going to happen or anything like that. Like, I really wanted to experience the movie for what it was worth. And a lot of times when we're doing these types of segments, it is hard to fully immerse yourself in the movie because you want to like take notes, you want to like remember what's going on, you want to score it properly. But for this, I had to like just put my phone down and like really focus initially. Once I got it, I was like, oh, okay, now I can actually like focus on it. So I'm going to kind of go through the story, and then we'll go and touch a little bit on the characters and the other types of categories as well. So like I said, this movie threw me for a loop when it first started, and it starts out with a girl in a forest who is surrounded by animals that she's feeding. Now, initially, I thought this was the actual movie, and obviously that's what they intended it to be. And this girl in the movie, she sees the blue bird. So you're automatically drawn to the fact of the story name for the movie. You're like, oh, okay, this is going to be relatable. And then you see how it was almost like a change in art style.
It is.
I want to say, because the book per se, when it switches back and forth to there, it's almost like a watercolor type of effect. And then it kind of switches back to like the actual animation style of Kyoto Animation. So that was what kind of gave it away to me. And I was like, oh, okay, the change in art style. Like, this is where the movie's actually starting. So that was really cool. And once we actually get into the movie, you're left thinking about that first and you're like, okay, well, how is this going to play into it? But it starts out where the girl, Mizori, who's sitting on the steps and she's just kind of like waiting and she's sitting there. She's lonely. There's nobody else around. You're not really sure what's going on. And then you're introduced to the other character, Nozomi. And the way that Nozomi was portrayed, it was kind of like Mizori was just kind of like following her. It wasn't, I couldn't figure out at first. I was like, does she know who that is? Like, is she like stalking her? Like, what is going on? And it was just kind of like a weird dynamic at first, but then you come to find out that they are best friends. They're the two main characters in the story and they're going to band practice. Now, before they get to band practice, they, the best friend, Nozomi, she finds this blue feather on the ground and you kind of make the connection. You're like, oh, okay, now I can see where this is going. And she turns around and she hands it to
Mizori,
and she was like, here, do you want this? And initially I'm like, why the fuck are you giving her a blue feather? And once I got to the very end of the movie, I was like, oh, it all kind of like goes back full circle. So they're going into school and then they're going to band practice to do this type of piece that the competition band has selected. And the competition band that they selected is based off of Liz and the Bluebird. Now, before the movie actually says what the piece is called, Nozomi brings out the book that she rented from the library called Liz and the Bluebird. And this is kind of where it starts talking about the book and how, sorry, my phone just like went off. This is where you kind of start seeing how the girl is lonely and she shows up and they become best friends. And this is the part where you realize that she was the Bluebird and she flew away. And during this whole entire scene, while this is playing out, I kind of got this like weird vibe between both of them. And I almost felt like there was like a romantic interest.
That, yeah.
Was that supposed to be
that
there?
That was supposed to be there.
Okay. Yeah. Cause I was like,
I'm glad you zeroed in on that, because it is a film where like there's definitely some chemistry and some kind of,
yeah,
you know, it's not overstated because it is Japanese. No. And Japanese culture, that kind of thing is not, it's not completely, what's the word I'm looking for, accepted yet.
Mm.
So there are elements of that, but it is definitely, they're putting it there, but they're not explicitly stating it, you know?
Okay. I can see that. I definitely would say that it's more prevalent in the beginning of the film towards the end of the film. And obviously for reasons that we'll get into, that's kind of why. And so at this point, it kind of switches back over to the actual like storybook fairy tale type of atmosphere. And it shows you the life of the main girl in the fairy tale, how she's a lonely life and she's only working. And this is where she finally meets the Bluebird. Okay. And this is kind of where you see the back and forth between the movie and the fairy tale. So what this movie does really, really well, and this kind of goes along with cinematography, but I'll mention it now because it's important. It brings you to a point where it's exactly where they want their viewer to be for the characters in the movie. So they show you the point where the girl is lonely, she's finding this blue bird, yada, yada, yada. And then the movie is mirroring the fairy tale. And then when it switches back over to it again, it will mirror the other part of the fairy tale. So I really liked that part. When it eventually gets back over to the movie part, you find that the other girls in the bassoon section, which they all play different instruments, that's not really important for the plot of the movie, But the other girls are trying to befriend the main character, Mizori, but she doesn't want to be in their company. It seems like she only wants to be around Nozomi, whatever her name is. She only wants to be around her because that's who she feels comfortable with. And it's at this point where you, like, you meet this one girl, and I told you when you came down that this girl, like, pisses me off. I don't even know what her name is, but it's the girl with the red hair, but her voice is so annoying. It's so annoying, and it just, I don't know. I could not get over the fact by how annoying it was. And it almost seemed like she was, like, obsessed with her, or I guess it was just the mystery and the fact that she wouldn't let her hang out with them in that type of atmosphere. But I don't know. I just got, like, a really weird vibe from her.
Okay. All right. Keep going.
Side plot. And we switch back over to the fairy tale, and it's introducing the girl who is the original bluebird to all different types of things and adventures. And this is where you start seeing the bonding coming in between the main girl in the fairy tale and the bluebird, which would be Liz and the bluebird.
Right.
And once we switch back over to the movie, because like we said, we're going back and forth between fairy tale and movie, this is kind of where the main character of the movie, she kind of gets her own copy of the book because she wants to explore it a little bit more. And you see that she's struggling internally about something, and then she can't really open up to anybody. Just because of her type of personality, she's not really trusting to anybody. She can't open up, and it seems like she's just awkward with making friends.
Yeah.
And they start talking about this piece that they're going to do for band, which we touched a little bit on before, but there's a solo piece, and the solo piece of this
arrangement,
thank you. The solo piece of this arrangement is going to become basically the center around the movie once we get past this next part with the fairy tale. And once it switches back over to the fairy tale portion, this is kind of where the fairy tale portion almost kind of stops, because the girl, she turns back into the bird and she flies out the window, and she does come back. But this is where you see Liz. She seems to realize that she's not an ordinary girl because she finds the blue feather. So she kind of makes the connection right then and there that it was kind of like this girl was sent to her from somewhere else. She's not this ordinary girl, but she's there to kind of like comfort her, to make her feel normal again, I guess.
Right.
This is kind of where it takes a turn for how we talked about how the solo is basically going to become increasingly more important in this movie aspect. So the piece that the band is doing a representation for, the arrangement, is the piece like we talked about for Liz and the Blue Bird. Now, the solo that is in this piece is a direct representation of how Liz and the Bluebird played out, and the fact that Liz let the Bluebird go, even though that they were best friends, and she just wanted to let her go. And we'll go a little bit more into that in a minute or so. So in this arrangement, there's two different instruments that accompany this arrangement, and which one was the flute, who is Nozomi, who is the main character of the best friend, who is kind of
the outgoing one. Yeah.
She's the outgoing one. And then there's the oboe, who is the main character, who's the one that's just kind of stuck and doesn't have many friends. So this is the representation of Liz and the Bluebird, and the duet is their parting. So the duet represents the parting where Liz essentially lets the bluebird go to basically spread her wings and fly away, that she doesn't want to hold her back anymore.
Right.
Because she felt that her keeping her there as her best friend was selfish, and she wasn't letting her spread her wings. Now, the main character, Mizori, there's kind of also like a side plot between her where she's trying to find her path in life, because I think they're in their junior, senior year.
I think they're in their senior year of high school. Yeah.
So this is the point where they're kind of like trying to figure out careers, and they're filling out career assessments. And she hands hers back in blank because she doesn't know what she wants to do with her life, because she's always following around her best friend. So whatever her best friend does, she does as well. So it's at this point where one of the professors in the school, she kind of confronts her and gives her information about a music school. And she was kind of hesitant at first about applying. But when she talks to her best friend about it, she was like, oh, well, maybe I'll apply. And this is where you kind of see really how much she relies on her best friend. Because as soon as she said that, she's like, oh, okay, I'll apply also. So this is where you see the dynamic between both of them kind of start to shift. And we still have the other people that are trying to befriend the main character,
Missouri,
and she still is really not trying to have it. She does eventually start talking to the other girl, and they start to bond over how to make reeds, and they invite her to the swimming pool. This is kind of where Nozomi kind of has a jealousy streak. She starts to see how her best friend is kind of blossoming into this other person, and she doesn't really like it because she is used to her kind of following around like a puppy dog, and she's kind of becoming her own and basically spreading her wings and flying, and she doesn't want that. So for the solo part, they obviously, the two best friends get the solo part because one of them plays the flute, the other one plays the oboe. And it's clear at this point in time that they're going to be parting in some way at the end of this movie. Like, there's not really a spoiler in this movie, so it's just inevitable. Because of the way that the Liz and the Blue Bird fairy tale ends, it's at this point when they're playing the solo, you're realizing, you're like, okay, well, the solo depicts their departing. Obviously, by the end of this movie, like, something's going to happen. So while they're doing the solo, you come to find out that Missouri, she's kind of like holding back. Like, she is a really, really good oboist, if that's what you want to call it.
I think that's the correct term.
Yeah. She's really, really good at playing the oboe. But there's been multiple people that keep on telling her that she's holding back. She's, for whatever reason, she's holding back her abilities to play. And she keeps on telling them, like, no, like, I'm doing my best or whatever it might be. But there's been more than one person that keeps on telling her this. You come to find out that she is holding back because she's afraid that her best friend will leave, like the blue bird in the book does. She fears that if she gives her all, that Nozomi, like the blue bird in Liz and the Blue Bird, she will fly away and she'll lose this best friend for life. And this is where the second shift in the dynamic is changing, because we talked about how the girl is looking, she's becoming more jealous. She's asking for different things, or she's asking for a hug, and she basically just tells her no. When initially at the beginning of the movie, she kind of introduces this concept of an I love you hug, and she was just like, oh, I'm just kidding. But now, since it's like the times have changed and she's the one that's doing it, she's kind of jealous by the fact that she's not the only person there anymore, and she denies her. So the main character is struggling with how Liz was feeling in the book, so the solo really isn't working. Missouri, she's trying to figure out why on earth Liz would let this bluebird go. It's supposed to be her best friend. She loves it so much. She doesn't understand why, if you love somebody so much, why would you let them go? However, after she continues to talk with her professor who gave her the information about the music school, you finally understand that Liz let the bluebird fly away because she loved her. So this is kind of where she really starts to explore the emotions behind the fairy tale. Like, she knew the concept of the fairy tale, but she couldn't fully understand the feelings behind Liz and behind the bluebird in the actual fairy tale. And because she finally figured out this whole feelings type of mantra for the book, this is where the solo comes together beautifully. And it's kind of this breathtaking moment in the whole entire movie. And you're just sitting there like, wow. Like, it was like a really, I think it was probably the most powerful scene in the whole entire movie. And it's at this time where her best friend, Nozomi, she's literally sitting there playing this piece, and she starts crying. And she knows right then and there that their friendship has kind of changed for the better. It is the better for both of them, although it's heartbreaking to watch because they both don't want to let go of what they kind of had before. So what happens is Nozomi, she kind of goes and she goes to the place where Mizori usually goes to go feed the blowfish, and she finds her there. And they kind of come to this realization where they both love each other, but they also both kind of have to let each other be free. So she starts talking about how she thinks that she was holding back with the oboe because she doesn't think that she can keep up with her, when in reality that was really the idea around it. But she's also, Mizori, she's also trying to convey to her that she's trying to tell her that she means everything to her and that she loves her. And this is kind of where the romantic kind of gestures keep coming back. But from there, it was a little bit different. So this, at this point in the movie, you're kind of waiting to see, like, okay, well, their relationship has changed, but how is it going to be played out at the end? So their priorities changed, where the main character is now, who is Mizori, she's focusing on her music more. And her best friend, Nozomi, she's focusing more on her studies. And it's really nice to see how Mizori kind of kept with music, because obviously it was something that she was really passionate about and she was really good at it. But they still have this dynamic of friendship, because they're still going to kind of maintain their friendship, where you see the last scene and they're like going out for lunch. But through the whole entire type of movie, you think that Liz and the Bluebird, the characters that portray them, so Liz would, in the beginning, would be portrayed as Mizori, and the Bluebird would be Nozomi. But at the end of the movie, there's a shift. So no longer are those characters played by each of them. Now Liz is...
There's like moments where they swap, where yes. It's Liz is then Nozomi and the Bluebird is Mizori. And then at the end, they're kind of both.
Yeah.
They're both Liz and the Bluebird.
Yeah. I really like that, because at one point in the movie, I was like, I thought I had them both pegged for which ones they represented in the fairy tale.
They lure
and
you
then
in.
At one point I was like, wait, now I'm not so sure. But once at the end, you're kind of led to believe that they both kind of represent, like how you said, each of them. And that's kind of where it's left. You don't really know what happens after school. It's just kind of left on a cliffhanger. So that was kind of the overall story plot. Like I said, there's not really a spoiler or anything in terms of that. For the characters for this movie, there were the two main characters. They didn't really go into any side characters. So you had Mizori, who was the main character. She was the quiet. She was introverted. She's in high school. She's the oboist. And she isolates herself from everyone except Nozomi, except towards the end, where she kind of starts to let in other friendships as well. And when I originally wrote this, she's depicted as Liz in the story. Now, obviously, it's a little bit of both, I find her more as the Bluebird, because she's kind of like spread her wings a lot and she's now flying on her own. Now, in retrospect for Nozomi, she's the best friend. She's outgoing and popular. She's the flutist or flautist. I know, right? She's spending time with other friends that are in the band. And like I said, she was supposed to be depicted as the Bluebird, but at the end, she kind of is now depicted as Liz. So there's a lot of character development in this story, and I really appreciate the depth of the characters that they kind of go into and how they don't stagnate. They're always constantly changing. In terms of direction and cinematography, I really, really enjoyed the back and forth between the fairy tale and the movie. And like we talked about, the switch off is directly related to the main character and her best friend. And it took it, it takes it in chunks and explores their own friendship. So nothing is really rushed. It's kind of really gone at a pretty good pace, I would say. There were parts in it where I was kind of like, this is a little bit slow for my liking. But overall, I would say the pacing was pretty good. I would say, though, that I was expecting for the best friend to leave at the end, I guess, for, like, their traditional Liz and the Bluebird. I guess in a way that they did kind of part each other, because one is pursuing music, the other one is pursuing her own studies. But I guess just, like, as metamorphic, or whatever the word would be, kind of, like, in relation to Liz and the Bluebird, like, I had pictured, like, just a parting of ways.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to be like a clean cut, but yeah. it is implied that because they're both going to separate schools,
yes.
it's how normal friendships work, right? Like, 'cause when we were in high school, you knew that there was friends that you're probably never going to see again, but you didn't just like end the relationship, yeah. right? You kind of just...
It's kind of like a soft
right.
removal
But
of
most
friendship.
Of them, you don't meet anymore.
No.
It's kind of those things where you're just like, well... Although in this, it does feel a little bit more that it's that you feel that like this is going to be the end. It's not going to be the end right away, but when we leave high school,
yeah,
we're probably going to go our separate ways.
100%. No, I definitely agree. But and then the last category we talked about with music and sound. My one pet peeve with music and sound. So at the beginning of this movie, where Mizori is sitting on the steps and she's waiting for Nozomi to come, there was literally a sound for every fucking movement, to the point where it was like overpowering at one point. It was like she would turn and her dress would swish, and it was just like the footsteps were so loud and overpowering in some scenes that it kind of like took away from the beauty of the animation a little bit. So that was like my only pet peeve. Other than that, the music honestly was spectacular in this movie. I think I have like appreciation for it because we were both in band in high school, and I have an appreciation for that type of music, especially because I also played the flute. So there was kind of a connection there. I think that was part of the reason why I really, really enjoyed it so much in terms of music. But I also really liked how whatever type of music or melody or whatever it was that they put in this movie, there was an emotion behind it. It wasn't just because for the fuck of it, I'm going to put in this song. There was always an emotion tied behind the music that was being played. So I really liked that. So, for overall scores, and I'm actually going to change one of them because as I was talking about it, I liked it a little bit more.
Okay.
Okay, so locking in my scores, not changing anything else anymore. Story, I gave a 4, which I originally gave a 3.
Okay.
I changed it while I was talking about it when I was kind of hashing it out with you. Characters, I gave a 4 as well because of the depth perception of the characters and the amount that they've changed throughout the whole entire thing. I definitely really appreciated that. No, nobody was stagnant. Nobody stayed the same. And it was kind of, even though it was a predictable movie, like I, as soon as I knew the Liz and the Bluebird story, I automatically knew it was going to happen, but I still appreciated it.
Mm-hmm.
direction and cinematography, kind of going off like what I just said, even though you know the outcome at the like almost probably like the 10-minute mark in the movie, it followed the direction perfectly. There was really nothing except for the few instances where it was a little bit slow in some parts. But other than that, I really didn't have any criticism. I would give it a 4 as well.
Okay.
And music and sound, I would have given this a 5 if the whole entire thing with the sounds overpowering, I just could not. So I gave it a 4 as well. And for overall enjoyment, I have to give it a 3. There were so many pieces of this movie that I really did like, but I did find myself like during certain aspects telling myself like if I turn this movie off at this point, like I wouldn't really care to finish it. I mean, it was it was a really good story. Like, I understand, like, you were even talking about it before we did the podcast. You're like, well, did you understand the symbolism? Or are you going to just tell me it was boring? Like, no, I had some actual criticism.
No, you did.
For the movie.
I'm very impressed.
But in terms of just, like, overall enjoyment, I would say probably because of the predictability aspect of it, I did give it a 3.
Okay. That's fair. I will say, and this is not pointed at you, this is in general for the people listening.
Mm-hmm.
If you haven't seen this movie, you should watch it.
Yes, I definitely agree.
I really love this movie. I'm not a huge fan of everything Kyoto Animation makes, but A Silent Voice I loved a lot.
Oh, I loved A Silent Voice.
Are you thinking of A Silent Voice or Your Name?
Oh, shit, I'm thinking of Your Name. Okay.
I liked A Silent Voice more than Your Name, and that's only because I could relate to it a lot more, because it explores, like, depression and anxiety.
Okay, fair enough.
Which, don't think you get the anxiety thing as much.
No, I don't.
I totally do, so I could totally feel that. This explores kind of the later years of high school for different perspectives, one being someone who kind of knows what they think they're going to, what they're doing, right, versus somebody who doesn't, you know? And I enjoyed that as much because I was the perspective of kind of a mix in high school, right? Where I kind of knew where I wanted to go, but I was also shy and I didn't really know, like...
You were very shy.
Yeah.
Like, painfully so. And even sometimes, like, even into college a little bit too, until finally you were just like, fuck it, I don't give a shit what other people think.
Yeah. But yeah, this movie was very emotional. Not going to say I cried during it. But I did feel stirrings. Which
I was going to say, if you cried during this movie, I'd be very surprised because I did not cry. I cry at everything.
Did you cry during this movie?
No, I did not.
Okay. I will say, though, A Silent Voice, I think, is the better movie compared to the two of them. I think they're both really good, but I think A Silent Voice more related to me more than this movie does.
Was Silent Voice the one with the
deaf girl, yes. Where they're in high school and the one boy bullied the girl... When they were in elementary school.
Wait, did I see that? I don't remember watching that.
Well, then you should watch it again. It's the remember the they were in kindergarten. They were in elementary school together. The one boy bullies this girl who's deaf. Ends up leaving school and transferring, and then it fast forwards to high school, like later high school, where she is in a different school. He has been bullied after that, and he's now going through anxiety and depression.
I remember like pieces of it.
Yeah.
But it's really good. I remember Your Name more so than A Silent Voice.
Yeah, it came out the same year as Your Name. And even in the beginning, like, he basically, like, it shows him almost trying to kill himself. And he stops himself, and he ends up meeting her later in high school. It's kind of explores them going back and forth and him trying to come to terms with, you know, his anxiety and his feelings and everything. It's a good movie. Yeah. You should watch it.
Well, if you haven't watched this movie or... A Silent Voice.
Watch both
of them. and anything kind of like... I like a lot of Kyoto Animation's type of movies. They're just, just their style.
They
like,
did Dragon Maid. The girl... Yeah.
I like that too.
Yeah, it's good.
Wait, weren't they the ones that burned to the ground?
Yeah, they were.
Oh, okay.
So that's the... Okay, I'm not going to get into that. I feel like I've talked that before, but... Yeah.
Moving on.
Okay.
On that note. So we kind of alluded to the fact that both of these, the movies that we both picked were similar in a sense in nature, but obviously completely different. So the movie that I gave Mike was The Greatest Showman.
Yeah. So The Greatest Showman is it's a musical biographical film, came out in 2017, and it explores...
Really? Was that long ago?
Yeah. And December 2017. And it explores P.T. Barnum, as in from Barnum and Bailey Circus, his life through musical form. So this stars Hugh Jackman, Zac Efron.
My favorite person ever.
Michelle Williams, Rebecca Ferguson, and Zendaya. And this movie, it's to go into detail. So it start. Let me just jump into it. So it begins with Hugh Jackman as an adult. He is singing, you know, one of the themes of the movie. to a crowd. He's with, you know, the circus and everything like that. And he's, and then as the song slowly fades out, it shows him as a child, and it shows him looking at a poster, and you get the sense that this is something he dreams about and what he wants to do. Obviously, if you know about Barnum & Bailey, you know he eventually does do that. And if you, it's obvious. But anyway, that's the movie. Kind of starts with that as him as a child. He is impoverished. He and his dad both work for a rich family. I gather his dad's a tailor, is what it looks like.
Yeah, I think so.
And Hugh Jackman is in love with the rich father's daughter, and he is very interested in her. They're both, you know, friendly with each other, and they both seem interested in each other. But the father is not happy, as in the girl's father is not happy that her daughter could be interested in somebody who's poor. So he does not approve of their friendship or even anything beyond that as well. And he gets wind of their relationship together and their friendship, and he decides to send off the girl to boarding school, which, you know, Hugh Jackman's character, well, the boy anyway, is, you know, obviously isn't happy about that, but he decides to write letters to the girl in the interim. And there's, you know, musical montages that show him going throughout his life, working for his dad. His dad eventually passes away and leaves his son his hat. And Hugh Jackman is, you know, tries to find work. He does, you know, menial odd jobs. And eventually, he's still writing the girl, works up the courage to ask for her hand in marriage. There's a musical montage showing, you know, them, you know, going together, getting a apartment or whatever, a house together.
There's a musical montage for everything in this movie.
It's kind of just showing them leading up to just before Hugh Jackman, you know, gets his first, you know, makes his first decision in terms of buying a circus or whatever. So that leads up to showing that the girl is pregnant, as in the woman he's married to, and, you know, it later will shows that he works at a bank, and that he obviously is not interested in working for the bank. He's doing what he can to help support his wife. The bank ends up foreclosing. I believe this is around the time of the Great Depression. I don't really remember. I didn't do enough research on P.T. Barnum. I know about Barnum Burke and Bailey Circus. I've never even been to it. I've never been a big circus person.
Neither have I, but you were deprived as a child if you've never been to the circus.
I never really was into the circus. It's not really that interesting to me. But anyway, side note. The bank that he works for ends up folding under. They made some bad investments, or I think they were saying that they had some investments in, like, ships, and those ships got sunk by, like, a typhoon or something. So then Hugh Jackman is left out of work, and he comes home to his wife and his two kids, and his wife tells him that, you know, she didn't think he was a good fit for it anyway, and that she thinks he'll, you know, find something that he's interested in. And he starts kind of seeing, you know, some things that inspire him, and he decides that he's going to purchase a piece of land, and it's a wax museum, basically, that he thinks that he can sell tickets to that people might be interested in. Doesn't work. Nobody's really interested in seeing a wax museum, and his kids kind of give him hints saying that he needs something live, something interesting, something, I think they say, spectacular.
Spectacular.
And he then decides to, through some inspiration, I think he was at a bank. I forget for what reason. I think he was just to get, like, a loan or something at the time. And he sees a dwarf, like a man, you know, a smaller man there. And initially he doesn't think of anything of it. And then he decides, hey, maybe I can, like, enlist him to help out. Okay. I mean, yeah, so he ends up going to the guy's house, and he decides, and he convinces him to join his troop. And it's weird, because he basically tells them that, like, the guy's like, yeah, you know, they all laugh at me, and he's like, yeah, well, you know, yeah, they'll be laughing at you, but, you know, you could at least kind of, like, embrace it or whatever. And I was like, okay, not a great message, but sure, all right, whatever. So then, not whatever, but I'm going to proceed along with the story. So he goes through kind of some montages of him looking for more and more people who are oddities to join his circus or his troupe. Those being the fat lady, so, you know, a girl with a beard, or the bearded lady, whatever. A person who's covered in hair, an extremely tall person, some acrobats, one of them which is Zendaya, and a couple other people. I don't remember them all. I think one of them's an albino. Anyway, and he starts putting on a show with them. Now, this draws a lot more people in because they're interested by these oddities. And I think what was kind of cool was that they kind of present them in a way that they're all kind of equal. Like, they're not putting on a show that I kind of think actually did happen then, where I'm pretty sure back then they kind of just put them in, like, cages or something.
Yeah.
And displayed them like freaks. But in this, they kind of make it seem like they're all, like, performers and things like that.
It's like they're unique gems that should be...
Right. They're kind of glossing over that part aspect that I'm pretty sure actually did happen, but... Okay, so I'm just proceeding along. So, yeah, they're kind of all, like, singing and doing, like, you know, montages about how, you know, they are different and everything, and, you know... That makes them special.
Hey, I really like that fucking song.
Okay, that song hasn't happened yet, but anyway. So, in the interim, there's people that are not happy with them portraying these oddities in this light. There are people that are, you know, throwing stuff at them. There's people that are, you know, getting into causing fights with them. But Hugh Jackman is getting more and more people to visit. He's getting more and more tickets, and he's able to start affording more and more things for his family. So he moved his family outside of their small house and into a much bigger one, with the goal that he's trying to give his wife, who came from a rich family, the life that he thinks that she deserves, as well as his kids. So his kids initially, you know, wanted things like, you know, ballerina shoes. They wanted to play, you know, perform the ballerina, and now he can do that. And it's with this that he ends up meeting Zac Efron at an event. Now that he is making more money, he's able to attend events with the high class people. And it's there that he meets Zac Efron, who is I think he's like, owns like I think it's like a play, like a theater. I think he owns like a theater where he puts on plays and stuff like that. Now Zac Efron makes good money, but he's not very happy with it. Like he's kind of in a place of stasis where he's not moving at all forward. He's just, yeah, I'm just putting on these plays. They're okay. You know, I'm just making money.
Just like doing it to do it.
Right. You know, he's happy with society, but he's not really doing anything with his life that he considers meaningful. He's waiting for like an inheritance and everything like that. So Hugh Jackman does like a montage with him where he's trying to convince Zac Efron's character to join his troupe, because he wants his influence. Because Zac Efron is in high society, he has a lot of connections. And Hugh Jackman wants those connections so that he can get more and more people, so he can put on more and more shows across the country. And initially, Zac Efron's character, whose name is Carlisle, by the way, is not really interested in that. He thinks that himself associating with Hugh Jackman will put his inheritance into jeopardy. And so he is initially wary of that, but Hugh Jackman tells him that, you know, you're in this state of, you're not happy with what you're doing. Don't you want to do something that you think you can enjoy? And eventually he convinces Carlisle, aka Zac Efron, to join his troupe, knowing that he could give up his inheritance. And right away, Zac Efron meets Zendaya during a show, and he instantly falls in love with her. And then it kind of starts moving along where they continue doing shows, and Zac Efron and Hugh Jackman attend a party where they are they don't attend a party. They are invited to meet the queen. And initially the rest of the troupe is afraid that they are not going to be invited along as well because they, you know, because of how they look. And Zac Efron says, you know, if you guys can't go, then none of us can go. And so they eventually all go, and the queen is intrigued by them, and they end up meeting, what's her name? Hold on a sec. I had it written down. Rebecca Ferguson's character, which is Jenny Lind. Jenny Lind is the is a Swedish singer called the Swedish Nightingale, and she is a very prominent singer throughout Europe. And Hugh Jackman immediately becomes interested in the idea of having her come back to America so he can do some shows with her, mm-hmm. and to kind of promote her, both in a way to increase her own fame across America, but as well as a way to increase his notoriety so that more and more people will see his shows. So he strikes a deal with her, he brings her back, and it's very clear that she immediately is interested in him. She knows that he's married and that he has kids, but she is still intrigued with him. So Hugh Jackman decides to start going on shows across the country with her, and his wife is immediately like kind of like off put by it, but she still lets it happen. It's clear that Hugh Jackman doesn't have a thing for her. He's more in love with her voice, yeah. than he is with her. Now, I don't know if this girl actually existed in real life and if this actually happened with Barnum and Barnum. I have the feeling if it did, he probably did end up getting with her anyway.
Probably.
But this movie does not portray it that way. Meanwhile, what's his name? Zac Efron's character is still into Zendaya, and he's had scenes with her, like when Jenny Lind plays in America for the first time, he's listening to her with Zendaya, and he goes to hold her hand, but then his parents see him and he immediately lets go. So she is angry with him, Zac Efron's character, because she thinks that he does not think she's good enough for him. And that's obviously not the case in this movie. It's more that he's afraid of committing because he doesn't want to lose his inheritance and he doesn't want to lose his image in front of his parents. And they end up, he ends up trying to take her out to a party, and he goes up the stairs with her, and his parents see them together and immediately tell him, you know, how can you show yourself with her? And she runs off, she's upset, and he tells his parents, you know, if this is the way you're going to treat her, I don't want my money or whatever. So then he runs off and does a, you know, montage with her, singing montage about, you know, how he doesn't really care about his life with money and whatever like that. He just wants her. And then meanwhile, Hugh Jackman is going across the country with Jenny Lind, and she ends up, after like several shows, trying to get with him. And he,
to put it lightly,
he's not going for it, and she gets upset, and he decides that he is going to leave her, like, as in let her continue her shows without him, because mm-hmm. he feels like he's being a distraction to her, to which she tells him that she's going to end them because, you know, she feels like he's been misleading her, and he tells her, you know, if you do this, you're going to be ruining me, to which she says, you know, she said she'll go on with it. She does a show. She's crying during the show, and she ends up kissing him in front of cameras in order to make the world know that he is a cheater.
Mm-hmm.
So he ends up heading back to his back home, to only to find his theater is on fire because people that did not approve of his show lit it on fire. Afterwards, he finds out that the bank will not give him a loan anymore because he lied about having collateral to be able to manage it. And meanwhile, his wife is leaving him because she saw in the papers that he kissed Jenny Lind. So, he's pretty depressed, and he's trying to find a way to get himself out of the rut. The whole troupe finds him at a bar, and they convince him that, you know, he made them, you know, who they are. He made them popular, even though they, you know, they look the way they are. They are the way they are. That they are, you know, he made them more than they are, right?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. You know, again, it's very like a lighthearted take on something.
It's like a feel good movie,
right? But it's a feel good movie on a take of something that clearly was totally not like that back in the day. But sure, let's kind of just go, let's gloss over that. You know, that's kind of how... So, long story short, he manages to hit Carlisle, as in Zac Efron, offers to give Hugh Jackman a loan, only this time they'll be 50-50 partners, wherein he will cover the cost of a new venue, and then he will help him get back on his feet, as well as the rest of the troupe. Meanwhile, Hugh Jackman ends up meeting up with his wife again. He gets her back after... It was really, like, quick. They kind of just were like, hey, you know, still love you. Okay, I love you too. And that was basically it. And Hugh Jackman decides to leave the reins of being the main showman of the ring to Zac Efron because he wants to spend the rest of his time with his family. And that's how the movie ends. So, yeah. There's not really much of a spoiler of this movie. Like,
No, there's not.
There's nothing there to spoil, really, you know?
No, because it's like a biography. It's like, yeah, it's his life.
Yeah, his life over a very glossy lens. So anyway, my thoughts on the movie. I took several notes here. So the first thing, let's start with the story in terms of how I pointed it. Overall, the story is fine. You know, it's a feel good movie, as you said. Like, there's nothing amazing in terms of how the plot goes. It's all a musical. So the most of it that is good about this is the music, right? The plot is fine, but it's not anything amazing. It's a very modern-esque movie, and by that I mean it portrays things in a very modern light. You know what I mean? Like, things are very like, oh, everything's great. You know, you're great. You look good. You know, you're amazing. Yeah, even though you're different, you know, different what makes you amazing. Even though that's clearly not how it was back then, but
well,
sure.
Well, it's a modernized take on it.
Yeah. Right. So it was fine. It was a fine movie. So are you telling me this movie was amazing? This was in terms of story. I'm not talking about music. I'm talking about story alone.
It's just his life. It's a biography.
Kind of. It's kind of a biography. It was fine. It was a fine movie. It wasn't anything amazing. Okay. It was fine. So I gave it a 3. Characters were pretty decent. I mean, there are several characters here, but the ones you mostly explore are Hugh Jackman's character, Zac Efron, kind of Zendaya, not too much, kind of his wife, a little bit of Jenny Lind, but it's mostly Zac Efron and Hugh Jackman. The acting was really good. It was mostly like a Hugh Jackman show, is what I felt like. I feel like if this was just a play on Broadway, it felt like a play on Broadway that they just recorded and added like After Effects. You know what I mean? Like, so characters were fine. There wasn't really anything complex. It was okay. You know, there were, other than like Zac Efron making that turn, but the turn was obvious. You know, he's rich. He comes from the family. He meets a girl it's obvious. I've seen it before. So I gave it a 3 as well. Music. I didn't actually have any problems with the music. Like, it's a musical. I'm not a big fan of musicals, but I can still appreciate that the music was good, and so was the sound design.
They were also original music.
Yeah, I understand. Oh, I know they were music, original music. I can't use any of it when I go to friggin' edit this, because it's all singing, and it's gonna be distracting, so I'm gonna have to actually find other music to put in the background for this segment. So, the music, the sound design, all that was pretty great. So I actually gave that a 5. Because I couldn't find any problems with the music. Even though it wasn't really to my taste, it was still really good. And there was some songs I actually really liked. Like the one with Jenny Lind that she sings. I really liked that song. I think that was probably my favorite song.
I don't remember it off the top of my head.
Okay. I'm sure you'll play it out after this or something.
Probably.
Next direction, cinematography. That was also really good. I actually need to update this because now that I'm thinking about it, I think it was better than I thought it was. Direction and cinematography. As I said, this feels like a play that they then recorded and then put in stitched in some After Effects, because there were some cool transitions, like the segue at the very beginning where he's singing in front of, you know, a crowd, and then it it switches to him as a kid, and then the montages of him going from a kid to an adult. The ones where he is, you know, where he's doing his first show, everything like that. It's really good. I don't really have any issues in terms of the direction and cinematography. I think that was a 5 as well. Overall enjoyment. So, is this a movie I think I could watch again? Probably not. it was fine. I think that the music is good and the direction's good, but it's not really something that I feel like I could watch multiple times. I think it's fine. You know, I feel like it's a more of a more you movie than me.
Well, if you guys haven't realized by now, there's a clearly definitive theme in all of my movies that I give you.
Yeah, Ashley likes, well, she doesn't just like musicals. Like, she likes dramas, specifically like teen dramas more than that.
Yeah. Chick flicks.
Yeah, chick flicks, stuff like that. This, it was a good movie. It wasn't my favorite movie, but I feel like in some retrospects it was, you know, I liked it, but I wouldn't rewatch it.
Fair okay? enough.
So I gave it a 3.
Okay.
All right. So overall, okay. So before we actually give our totals, can you read back what you gave?
Yeah. So story, I gave a 4. Characters were a 4. Direction and cinematography was a 4. Music and sound was a 4. And overall enjoyment was a 3.
Okay. What does that add to?
I don't know. I didn't add it up.
Wow. Okay. While she's adding that up, I can read out mine. So I gave story a 3. Characters a 3. Music and sound design a 5. Direction and cinematography a 5. Overall enjoyment a 3. What does that add up to for you? I'm really curious.
19.
I also put 19.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Okay.
So we tied.
So this is our first tie. And I have not come up with a solution for what we do when we tie.
I mean, we could both just get a point.
Sure. Let's both get a point, which means nothing changes. But okay. So for now we tie.
We'll have to think of a tiebreaker.
We'll have to think of a tiebreaker. Maybe,
I'm actually really surprised that we tied, to yeah, be completely honest with you.
I had a feeling it was going to happen sometime. I didn't think it was going to happen so soon.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, and surprisingly, when I adjusted those points,
mm-hmm,
I scaled one up and I scaled one down. So it didn't change anything. It still was 19. So yeah, interesting. Okay. So with that, I'm going to leave some... Oh, actually, sorry. Before we sign off, I know it's getting kind of late for us, but we did actually have an email come in.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So we do have... Usually I add this at the end during our notes, but I will say that we do have an email if you want to send us some questions or some comments or some suggestions for things that you might want us to either explore together or explore... because you might think it's something that either one of us might like that we watch and then can pitch to the other. So our email address is warrenlove@gmail.com. So if you want to send us anything, you can, you know, email us there. But we did actually get an email recently, and this is from Comiskey's Projects. And he asked us, "Hi, Mike and Ashley. Hope you guys are staying safe in these weird times. Hypothetical question, if you were trapped on an island and had only 3 pieces of media, film, video game, book, etc., to keep you entertained, what would they be?"
Oh.
Yeah? So, I've read this already, and I thought about it, and I kind of want to address this in 2 different ways, because, and I know one of them is kind of cheating, but I want to do it in 2 ways. The first is...
Of course, cheater.
The first is, because it says, like, 3 pieces of media, film, video game, books, etc., when I think of it that way... that would exclude TV series, because if it's one piece, like one, right, you can't watch an entire series or something. So the cheat way is you can bring an entire series as one of those things, an entire book series is one of those things, an entire like manga or something like that is one of those things, but only one series or something like that, right?
Okay.
And then the real way is, no, you can only pick one. So if you like a series, that's out. If you like a book series, you can only bring one of those books from that series or something like that, right? So I'm going to talk about my things. If you haven't thought of anything yet, you can think about it while I'm saying mine, okay?
Okay.
All right. So for my cheat way first, For in terms of video game, honestly, like, it's gonna be the same for both cheat and not cheat. I'm gonna bring Final Fantasy VII because I love that game. In terms of manga series, I would bring One Piece, and that's mainly because it's not even my favorite manga. It's so fucking long that, like, it would take, I could easily reread it multiple times. Like, it's up to almost 1,000 chapters right now. It's a lot. It would take me a while, so it would definitely entertain me for a long time. And then in terms of anime, probably Hunter x Hunter. Again, Hunter x Hunter actually isn't my favorite anime either, but...
Oh, I'm very well aware.
But it's a long enough series where I enjoy it, and I enjoy rewatching it all the time because it's such a good series. So there's that. Now, I can do, like, my real one, or you can move on to your cheat one as well if you have a cheat one.
I would say for TV series, it's going to be Grey's Anatomy.
Okay.
There's just so many episodes, and they just keep coming out with any, with so many of them, and it just kind of keeps me on my toes. For book series, I would honestly probably say Harry Potter.
Okay.
I feel like Harry Potter is a series that I can continuously go back to time and time again and still be wowed by the books and just kind of the depth of imagination the worlds are kind of shaped into. So I would say definitely Harry Potter. I don't really know. I don't really have anything else that I would, it would probably be like a must.
Okay.
I would say movie wise, like if I had to pick an anime movie, I would pick Weathering You.
Okay. All right. That's a good one. In terms of my real list, again, I said video game would still be Final Fantasy VII. Book would be Watchmen. I love Watchmen. It's a great comic. And it's still kind of relevant today. So I would totally reread that. It's long enough to where I can enjoy it, but still go back and reread it. And then in terms of film, it would probably... that's a toughie. It would probably be... it would probably be the Cowboy Bebop movie, actually. I really like the Cowboy Bebop movie.
There's a movie?
Yeah, there is a movie. Of course there is. It takes place between like episodes like 20...
I thought you would have said Dark Knight.
The Dark Knight is good, but I feel like the Cowboy Bebop movie is really fun and enjoyable. Fair enough. I could go back and rewatch that multiple times. What about you for a real list?
Well, if I had to pick one of the Harry Potter books, I'd probably say Goblet of Fire.
That's your favorite one?
Yeah, I really like that one.
Okay.
I feel like I liked that one just because it kind of explored like other aspects of Hogwarts and whatnot. Although I really liked the ending of the series too. So that's kind of a hard one, too.
Yeah, my favorite book is Half-Blood Prince, and I think that's mainly because...
It's a toss-up between both of them for me.
Okay. Yeah, Half-Blood Prince I like a lot because I like how they explore like Voldemort's past, which I find really interesting.
Yeah, I agree.
Go ahead.
Well, movie is still Weathering You because it's a movie.
And then one more thing you gotta bring with you. It can be like a...
I'm bringing Netflix.
No, you can't bring Netflix. It's cheating.
I don't know.
Is there any other movie that you... or TV... or even a video game that you think you could play?
The original Super Mario Brothers.
Okay. Alright.
Like, the original, not the, like, shit that comes out
now. Could
you even
beat the original now?
Probably not. But I have more of a chance of beating that because there's no Joy-Con.
Not even 64?
No, it had to be the one that was gray and purple.
Oh, my God. All right. Okay, then. I have a feeling you'd get bored of that really quickly. But all right. Again, if you have any questions or anything, send us an email at warrenlovepodcast@gmail.com. As Ashley mentioned, we recently released part 2 of our Let's Play. I do not know if we're going to have a part 3 because I don't think Ashley enjoyed the ending of part 2. We will see.
I want to play as the other character, but at the same time, I'm like, I just need to get better at using the controller.
Yeah. We have a little bit of time anyway, because recently our TV died, the one that we've been using.
Yeah.
And I have to get a new one. So that's kind of holding things back.
Great time for it to die during quarantine.
Right. And yeah, other than that, to shout out how you can reach us or how you can follow us, we are on Twitter at Warren Lovecast. We're also on Instagram at Warren Lovecast. You can follow me on Twitter as well at Mr. Space Lion. I tend to post some updates of where we're at. If not, I'm not on the main Twitter. We also have a Discord now, which is linked on our Warren Lovecast Twitter. So if you want to hop in there, it is not locked, so you don't need a Patreon or anything like that. You can join whenever you want. And other than that,
until next time, guys.
Yeah. So thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
We'll see you later.
Bye.